Good afternoon, everyone, and very warm welcome to St Paul's Cathedral for this Sunday forum session. My name is Rosemary Morton and I'm one of the clergy here at St Paul's, and it's my great pleasure to be here today to chair this session and to welcome today's speaker. John Pritchard was Bishop of Oxford until 2014. Prior to that, he read law at St Peter's College, but whilst there recognised a call to ordained ministry and went on to gain qualifications in theology at Oxford, Cambridge and Durham, a pretty no mean feat for anyone, I think. He was ordained in 1972 and is the author of many books on the Christian life, including the book that we're going to hear about today, Living Easter Through the Year. We're really excited to be welcoming John today, and we're looking forward to what he's going to tell us about living Easter through the year. So would you please join me in welcoming John Pritchard.
Rosemary, thank you very much, and thank you for coming. It does seem to be a very awkward time, really, but you come, so thank you. Good to see you. I've come a long way. I've come from Richmond in North Yorkshire. Not the local one, too expensive, but North Yorkshire is a very nice place to live, though it's nothing like as warm as it is down here. So I'm pleased to be here, but with a daughter living in Hampstead as well, and three little grandchildren there, it gives me the opportunity to see them too. So lovely to be with you. I heard a lovely story recently about a famous lawyer called F.E. Smith. Anyone heard of him? So a famous guy who apparently was a good friend of Winston Churchill, and the story goes that F.E. Smith was in the House of Commons on one occasion soon after lunch and came across Winston Churchill rather filling the chair that he was sitting in. He'd had a very good lunch and he was rather rotund anyway, but he looked rather large, and F.E. Smith said to Winston Churchill, he said, so are you expecting a boy or a girl, Winston? And Winston Churchill said, well, if it's a boy, I'll call it John, and if it's a girl, I'll call it Mary. But if, as I rather suspect, it's just a bag of hot air, I'll call it F.E. Smith. I hope, it's my intention not to give you a bag of hot air today in this hour we've got. But I do have a fascination with the way that Easter is kind of the forgotten festival, strangely. Although it's our great festival, although it's our king of festivals, it gets shortchanged, I think. And so one of my desires in ministry has been to kind of embed Easter more fully at the heart of our lives as Christians. Obviously, Christmas lasts about 3 months, doesn't it? You know, you get your first catalogue in August, and then it just builds from there. And so you're very conscious of Christmas all the time. Easter comes upon us rather strangely because we've been through the somber season of Lent, and we've had the very serious and wonderful Holy Week, and we've been through the traumas of Good Friday. Then we have this one day of ecstasy, Easter Day. And then it's a bank holiday and we start thinking about our holidays. Or we jet off to the sun or whatever. And Easter's gone. And although liturgically it remains, stays with us, nevertheless in our experience it seems to die the death. So here is Easter, which is actually the air that we breathe as Christians. It's the screensaver of our lives, isn't it, as Christians? If there were no Easter, we would not be here this lunchtime. So the stakes are very high with Easter, and our whole faith is rooted there, and without it, we have nothing but a fake Messiah who had a very horrible death. And this Easter event is not just a kind of a first of its kind in history. It's not something that would go into the Guinness Book of Records as, you know, raised from the dead, first recorded occurrence. It's not like that. It's the first in principle. Other resurrections or other returns to life, you know, Lazarus, etc., are temporary, transient, utterly different from this first in principle a defeating of death, as it were. It's also not just a past event, not just an event like later today, I hope we'll be saying, England beat the West Indies in the 2020 final, etc., for those who are not cricketers. That's the illusion. You know, or we joined the common market in, I don't know, when was it, 1972 or something like that. You know, it's not an event in past history like that. It's not, Thomas, for instance, you know, would not have said, gosh, so the dead do rise after all, how interesting. You know, he was on his knees saying, my Lord and my God. So it's an utterly different kind of, it's not just an event in history, but an event that transforms people, including us. And nor is it just a, you know, conventional happy ending story, so that, you know, it was erasing the mistake of the cross. Sorry about that, that went wrong, we can put that right, you know, we'll raise Jesus. It's not like that either, because the cross was utterly central, and the resurrection brings the denouement to the whole of Jesus' life. So it's not putting right something that was wrong, it's moving it on to the completion of all that Jesus had to do. So what we have in the resurrection is this utterly new story. You know, it isn't one story that's just continued to the next stage. There's a gap, there's a hole. It's called Easter Saturday, but it is an utter darkness. My mother-in-law used to hate that day because it was the only day on which Jesus wasn't alive in her chronology, as it were, her calendar. And so there is this complete gap. There's the genuine ending, there's the profound darkness, and then there's the resurrection. So it's a new story, it's a new creation. And it's that newness, it's that sense of newness, the sense that everything is gift, that I'm wanting us to live with longer than just that one morning of Easter Day. I don't want, in the short time I've got, to get into all the evidence for the resurrection kind of stuff. We can talk about that if you'd like to question that afterwards. But there is plenty of evidence around. There's lots we can look to the empty tomb and say, well, nobody actually ever questioned that the tomb was empty. The question was, why was it empty? You know, had the Jewish authorities taken the body away, well, then why didn't they produce it? Immediately, these silly rumours started going around. You know, did the Roman authorities take the body away? Well, same thing. You know, why not just produce it when things started getting out of control? You know, we have this empty tomb, and all sorts of other things we could say about the empty tomb, but it doesn't seem to have been questioned by the early tradition. It's interesting, actually, isn't it, that there's no evidence, in the first 3 centuries at any rate, of anyone going to the tomb to venerate it. Whereas usually you go to the place of the death and events, you know, that are significant. There's a huge tradition of veneration of the dead. But no one goes there because Jesus is raised. It's interesting when you read the accounts as well. The accounts of the resurrection are so fresh, so new, so different. And they're not drawing on the Old Testament as so much of the rest of the Gospel does, even the accounts of the crucifixion, drawing on the Old Testament. Here is something completely new. Now, there are lots of things we could talk about on another occasion, about the empty tomb. The empty tomb, therefore, is necessary, but it's not sufficient. So then you say, well, what about those appearances? Extraordinary range of appearances over a prolonged period of time, to individuals, to pairs, to groups, to 500 at one time, you know, all sorts of different experiences, none of which have the kind of appearance of hallucination, ghostly appearance, you know, or memory, but the vividness, the touch, the or the invitation to touch, and in some cases the touch and the eating and so on, they are of a different order from the hallucinations that one might have after a particularly bad night or whatever. So there's a whole lot of stuff we could look at about the appearances. And then you have to say, here's another piece of evidence, the disciples themselves. Extraordinary before and after story, isn't it, with the disciples? Where before you have this frightened group of men who have beaten a hasty retreat when the crucifixion came close, who are scared out of their wits that they'd be the next people up on the cross, who are hiding around the city. And then they just emerge and conquer the world. You know, within 300 years, even the Roman Empire has given in and become officially Christian. The turnaround in those disciples needs some extraordinary event, and not, I would suggest, just the revival of memory, the realizing that Jesus got it right after all, you know, a spiritual resurrection or an emotional response. I think something much more than that was needed to send those people to their deaths, because all but John, it would seem, died fairly nasty deaths for that faith. Or another piece of evidence you could look at would be the just the existence of the church itself, wouldn't it be? Because there is a church which now has 2.3 billion members. That's quite a growth from 11 people on Good Friday night. You know, 2.3 billion members, and a church which is growing at the rate of 70,000 more Christians every day of the year, net growth worldwide. You know, huge growth going on in the church. A third of the world's population names the name of Christ. Could all of that be based on a lie? I would suggest not. So there's the empty tomb, there's the appearance of the disciples, to the disciples, there's the change in the disciples, there's the existence of the church. There's the remarkable things that people were saying about Jesus. People who'd known him, people who'd, you know, done a washing up with him, had barbecues on the beach, played frisbee with him, you know, whatever they did on the route, on the path. You know, these people who'd known him were calling him the most outrageously extravagant, kingly, divine names just a few years after his death and resurrection. Something, again, sufficient to justify that kind of extraordinary naming of Jesus. And I suppose, sixthly, you could also just talk about the experience of Christians, couldn't you, and say there are millions of people who throughout history have said in some way or other, however you describe it, they've encountered a living Christ. And they can no more deny that than they can deny their own parenthood. You know, it's there, it's been part of their experience. So we have a lot of things we could look to, but as I say, I'm not intending to go into all that really. That was just very much in passing. I used to work with Tom Wright. He was Bishop of Durham and I was his suffragan when I was Bishop of Jarrow. And Tom, of course, is writing this huge series of books on the Gospels and Paul and the people of God. And he thought he'd do the resurrection in the last 80 pages of one of these books. But he didn't quite manage it. It emerged as the resurrection of the Son of God, 800 pages. And, you know, wonderful book as it is. And he writes so readably as well. I wouldn't suggest starting at page one and going right the way through to 800, though. It is a long read, but fascinating. So there's lots in there. Reasons for confidence, therefore. But what I'm really wanting us to think about is how to live that experience, how to enjoy, how to inhabit that experience and make resurrection more of the touchstone of our faith, the air that we breathe, as I say. Though I want to say one other thing. People do sometimes get worried about the four different accounts that you have of the resurrection in the four Gospels. Very different accounts as they are, though with common themes all the way through. I would suggest that after England's great victory this afternoon over West Indies in the 2020 final, World Cup final, there will be different ways of recording that, reporting on that victory. Depending on whether you're a West Indian or an English person or someone neutral, you know, you just get different accounts because you're looking at it from different angles. And I like to think sometimes of these four Gospels as like, you know, four people watching a football match. And Matthew is rather like the person in the stands who's got the big view, the overall view, the big picture. Matthew is kind of looking at the origins of this whole story of God's activity, which comes to a culmination in Christ. And he's seeing the whole picture through Jewish eyes. And he's drawing his conclusions from a deep story. He's, as it were, able to see all the corner flags on the pitch. And he's showing why that story is so significant. But then you have Mark. He's really got the view from behind the goal. You know, very vivid, very immediate, very real, as it were. Very you know, the bustle that's going on the pitch is right there in his face, as it were. Unfortunately, his report, well, the end of it got lost on his way back from the match. Do you know the lost ending of Mark? Well, I think it's a lost ending. I mean, something, it finishes at verse 8, 16 verse 8, which just says that they went away, the women went away in fear. However, it's a very vivid description. It's a tabloid description, I suppose. But then you've got Luke. Luke has got the view from the media box. And he's the one who's got a story to tell, which he wants to tell accurately, because he wants to persuade Theophilus that this Christian story can be trusted, and these Christians can be trusted. So he's trying to tell the story in as honest a way as he can, having got all the facts that he can, and giving an honest match report. Though he is a journalist with flair, is our Luke, because you can see that he's one to convince through hard history. But he also has these lovely touches, you know, the walk to Emmaus, his concern for women, his concern with the injury list as well on the pitch, you know, the physician. So there's a different view from the media box. And then there's John. His view is really from the manager's bench, I think, because he's the one who's got the inside story. He knows what the guys out there are thinking and doing. He knows what Jesus thought and did. He was close. So he knows the kind of strategy and tactics of the game. He knows the people. So he's the manager on the bench. So do you see what I mean? Four just different views from the stands, from the behind the goal, from the media box, from the manager's bench. Just different ways of looking at it. Of course they will be different. But the essence, the heart of it, the empty tomb, the appearance of the disciples, the angelic messengers, the women having a key role, the apostles to the apostles and so on, you know, all that is common. So, I think one of the ways of responding to the resurrection is through the arts. Because I'm never going to, none of us is ever going to understand what this resurrection is about. It's far too big for us. All we have is a kind of prism, the resurrection. As the light shines on this prism, the light of the resurrection, it's just split into, you know, a thousand pieces. And we catch a few of those pieces. And and I think one of the ways of responding, therefore, is through the arts, is just letting poetry and music and theatre and, you know, painting, art, you know, do the telling for us, really. I want to read, therefore, one or two poems as we go through this 45 minutes or so together. Here's one by John Updike. Do you remember the novelist, the Rabbit series? John Updike. And he's taking this story of resurrection and saying, listen, guys, this is real. And he takes it to its logical conclusion. This poem is called Seven Stanzas for Easter. Make no mistake, if he rose at all, it was as his body. If the cell's dissolution did not reverse, the molecules re-knit, the amino acids rekindle, the church will fall. It was not the flowers, each soft spring recurrent. It was not as his spirit in the mouths and fuddled eyes of the 11 apostles. It was as his flesh, ours. The same hinged thumbs and toes, the same valved heart that pierced, died, withered, paused, and then regathered out of enduring might new strength to enclose. Let us not mock God with metaphor, analogy, sidestepping transcendence, making of the event a parable, a sign painted in the faded credulity of earlier ages. Let us walk through the door. The stone is rolled back, not papier-mâché, not a stone in a story, but the vast rock of materiality that in the slow grinding of time will eclipse for each of us the wide light of day. And if we will have an angel at the tomb, make it a real angel, weighty with Max Planck's quanta, vivid with hair, opaque in the dawn light, robed in real linen, spun on a definite loom. Let us not seek to make it less monstrous for our own convenience, or our sense of beauty, lest, awakened in one unthinkable hour, we are embarrassed by the miracle and crushed by remonstrance. Do you see what I mean? He takes it to its limit. Not sure I entirely go with it, but I don't know. The same hinged thumbs and toes, the same valved heart. However, fascinating. Here's not a theologian, but writing of his conviction of the reality, the materiality of whatever this spiritual body was. Anyway, the arts. Let me just move on to something about the implications of the resurrection. The implications for us, for our lives. I'm going to offer five. And the first one is this. If the resurrection is, as I'm saying it is, then we have a transforming friendship. Gregory of Nyssa, you know, the most important thing is to be God's friend. D.H. Lawrence, all that matters is to be at one with the living God. And this living God has, in the mouth of Jesus, said we can call him Jesus, our friend. When my wife was at school, she had some peers in her class who she was intrigued with. And they had this Christian group that she went along to, but they had a kind of something which intrigued her. She started reading a book, which some of you may have come across, called Who Moved the Stone? Frank Morrison. Is that right? Frank Morrison, I think. And she just sort of followed the implications of this through. Okay, it was Frank Morrison. He was a journalist, and he set out to disprove the resurrection, apparently, but became convinced of its truth. And Wendy read this, and she came to the conclusion, okay, I believe that. That seems right. Therefore, that Jesus is alive and in some way accessible to relationship. I think it was what made the difference for me as well. I mean, Wendy and I met at Oxford, but when I went up, I went with a whole scattering of Christian stuff around me, you know, in as much as I knew bits about the Bible and about church and about prayers and all sorts of things, you know, but I'd missed the central figure. Didn't have the middle piece of the jigsaw. And only when I put that in place did the rest fit in. And I can remember, you know, wonderful, if anyone knows Oxford, you know, walking down the Abingdon Road to my digs for 2 years, when I learnt about prayer, or that a particular type of prayer anyway at that time. And just that relationship in some way with the living God who I saw focused in Jesus, that was just remarkable. And the basis of a long-time fascination with how to pray. But we have a friend, and sometimes it seems to be quite almost blasphemous to talk about friendship with God, because, you know, another part of me says, hang on, you know, think of light coming from the Big Bang for 13.7 billion years at 186,000 miles per second, speed of light. Can I repeat that? 13.7 billion years at 186,000 miles a second. And if I'm saying God is the God of all that, the God of everything, then how can God be concerned about this young Oxford undergraduate walking down the Abingdon Road trying to pray? But then you say, you know, the light of the sun, incredibly powerful at its source, and yet able to warm me on a beach in, you know, Tenerife in my fantasy. you know, so able to do the huge fusion of the sun and also the warming of somebody on a beach. God similarly can encompass the whole. So friendship is appropriate. We have a friend. Second implication, we are an Easter people. And Alleluia is our song. Corporately, we are an Easter people. We won't always feel it. You know, we won't be bouncing around all the time. We mustn't overclaim our faith. You know, it'll always be joyful. Of course it won't. It'll be tough. Life will be tough. Everybody here will have had their tragedies. We know it's tough. But this Christian vantage point enables us to be on the mountaintop and to see the big picture, and to know that actually Alleluia is our song, that Christ is risen. I think my kind of life verse, if you're allowed to have one, would be John 10:10. I have come that they may have life and have it in abundance. That's why I'm a priest and not a wealthy lawyer, as I set out to be. First degrees in law. So here is a faith that makes us, in a sense, hungry for life. John V. Taylor, one of my heroes of faith, he was a Bishop of Winchester. He'd been Chief Secretary, General Secretary of CMS. But he once said, let's try and get this right, it's long been my conviction that God is not terribly interested in whether we're religious or not. What he is interested in is whether we are alive or not. And he said, if your religion brings you more fully to life, then God will be in it. But if your religion diminishes your enjoyment of life or makes you run away from it, then God will be against it, just as Jesus was. And I think it is that, you know, God is interested in whether we are alive, and the resurrection is the key to that, to our affirmation, enjoyment of life. Because if it's true, as when I was Bishop of Oxford, we had our kind of strap line was, you know, our vision was the transformation of all human life under God. The the transformation of all human life. That's huge. But that's what we were trying to say, was that a healed creation will involve, you know, politics and business and financial systems and you know, the legal system and economics and the arts and the environment and prison reform and everything. You know, it all matters. Matter matters. And that's because God has created and recreated this good world and has a glorious plan for it. We are an Easter people, and Alleluia is our song. It's a nice story of Mervyn Stockwood. He was the Bishop of Southwark, and it was an occasion when he was in Moscow, in a time when communism still ruled. Brezhnev was president, and Mervyn Stockwood went downstairs from his hotel to get a shave, because he'd, I don't know, lost his shaver or something. And he went down to the hotel barber's to get a shave. And as he was having his shave, the person doing it for him saw his Episcopal cross, you know, and his ring. And she said in some way, you know, Bishop? And he said, yes. And so she, you know, she took it and she kissed it and so on. And then she held the razor aloft with half of Mervyn Stockwood's beard on it. And she just said, Alleluia, Christ is risen. And the rest of the barber shop said, he is risen indeed. Alleluia. And Mervyn Stockwood thought, poor old Brezhnev, 60 years of communism and still the Galilean conquers. We are an Easter people. Third implication, we do have a transforming agenda. We have something to live for that is really quite wonderful. And it is this transformation of all human life under God. I think I started out in ministry with only half a gospel. I had this new experience of the Christian faith, and I really wanted to share that. I wanted people to be invited into that experience. But what I hadn't got was the whole social implications, the political implications of the gospel. That if God is as he is in Jesus, if the kingdom of God really is his gift to us, God's gift to us, then that has implications for us doing the groundwork of the kingdom now. Us working on the foundations. And so, you know, I began to kind of work it out. And therefore I've had lots of other heroes in my life, you know, Desmond Tutu, for instance. Lovely story of Desmond Tutu, in a time of apartheid. And he was, there was going to be a big demonstration outside the cathedral in Cape Town. And the army and the police cancelled it. So Desmond Tutu, as Archbishop, invited them all in, everybody in, to the cathedral, where they couldn't do any harm, or at least he thought they couldn't. But the police and the army ringed the whole cathedral. Can you imagine us here and the whole place surrounded against the wall with these nasty-looking people with guns? And Desmond Tutu preached, and he really preached to them, and he said, you are powerful. Well, at least you think you're powerful. But you're not God, he said, and God is not mocked. And I just want to tell you, you've already lost. So he came up from behind his pulpit and he said to them all, so why not come and join the winning side? Just a lovely confidence that nothing can resist the kingdom of God. Ultimately. And it's that kingdom that we work for, and it's that kingdom that Christians across the world give their lives for in compassion and in working for social justice. Why not join the winning side? Here's a fourth implication. We bring hope to a world with very little hope. Christians are people of hope, and I think in a world where there's a lot of despair at the moment. It is a key gift that we can bring. And we have to remind ourselves of why we have that hope, perhaps quite often, as we see what's happening in the world around us. But, you know, we have this trajectory, this big arc, as it were, of world history, which we see in the light of the resurrection. So, you know, we have a story that's historically rooted, the story of God, the story of Jesus. We have a present in which we are utterly committed to building the kingdom, or the foundations anyway. And we have a future that we know is safe in God's hands. We know the kingdom of God is unstoppable. It's just a matter of how we get there. So we have this whole arc. And our society and our culture lives so much in either just in the present, you know, experience without meaning, or else in the future, and trying to bring on the future faster than we can assimilate it. And what we can do is to remind people of that whole trajectory, the whole arc of God's loving activity in history, in the present, and in the future. Jim Wallace of the Sojourners, may have heard of him. He wants to find hope like this. He said, hope is believing in spite of the evidence and then watching the evidence change. It's a nice description, I think. Hope is believing in spite of the evidence and then watching the evidence change. And last, of just five implications that I've chosen. You know, we can approach death with a kind of humble confidence. We're coming before God, and no matter how much we know him now as Father, nevertheless, there is, in a sense, a judgment. You put yourself before God. Judgment doesn't mean condemnation, by the way. You know, judgment is neutral. Judgment is discernment, understanding, evaluation of a life. Condemnation is different. But, you know, there is a seriousness about coming before the Father and to be known through and through. But it's being known by love, which just makes it so different. I don't think I've got time to. I was going to give a lovely example from a friend of mine who's died recently, but who wrote such a beautiful, confident affirmation in it about his experience there. Because I want to read another poem. Again, this is about implications, the implications of the resurrection. But this is one by Gerard Kelly, and his poem is just called, it's online, it's where I got it. It's called Because He Is Risen. Because He Is Risen, spring is possible in all the cold, hard places gripped by winter. And freedom jumps the queue to take fear's place as our focus. Because He is risen. Because He is risen, my future is an epic novel where once it was a mere short story. My contract on life is renewed in perpetuity. My options are open-ended. My travel plans are cosmic. Because He is risen. Because He is risen, healing is on order and assured, and every disability will bow before the endless dance of His ability. And my grave too will open when my life is restored. For this frail and fragile body will not be the final word on my condition. Because He is risen. Because He is risen, hunger will go begging in the streets for want of a home. And selfishness will have a shortened shelf life. And we will throng to the funeral of famine and dance on the callous grave of war. And poverty will be history in our history because He is risen. And because He is risen, a fire burns in my bones and my eyes see possibilities and my heart hears hope like a whisper on the wind. And the song that rises in me will not be silenced as life disrupts this shadowed place of death, like a butterfly under the skin. And death itself runs terrified to hide because He is risen. Let's just have a think, just a few final minutes, about the difference that the resurrection can make to our praying, and what we, you know, what we take seriously in our ongoing spiritual life. Reese, before that, can I just say, I wonder what you made of Easter, say only a week ago, in your home. Because I think about what we do for Christmas, and we do loads, don't we? We don't do very much usually at Easter, but why not have Easter decorations as well as Christmas decorations? You know, the colours seem to be yellow and white. Why don't we have yellow and white streamers in our houses? And lots of daffodils and table decorations and, you know, all sorts of things to actually make Easter decorations as well as Christmas decorations. When we have our Easter meal, big meal, I hope, why not have that really laid out as a spread? It'll be lamb, I hope, that's what we're supposed to have. Not if you're vegetarian, but, you know, it'll be a really nicely laid out. Why don't we have one vacant seat there as well, for the risen Christ. And of course we can give away that money too, that's an extra we can do. You know how we have crib scenes at Christmas? Why don't we have in each of our homes an Easter garden? We do in our churches. Why not just use a tray, you know, and some stones and a bit of moss and, you know, whatever, as a reminder, visual reminder in front of us all the time. Why don't we give Easter gifts like we give Christmas gifts, but much simpler ones? Ones that kind of are more natural, more life-affirming, gentler, simpler gifts. Music, a good book, flowers, simple food, you know. Why don't we give gifts more often? So I just think we could build Easter a lot more than we do. But then prayer. How about going on with prayer? In terms of personal prayer, all corporate prayer, it's lovely for quite a long time after Easter to begin any encounter, that prayerful encounter, with our Easter greeting, Alleluia, Christ is risen. He's risen indeed, Alleluia. Why, when we just meet each other as Christians, don't we greet each other like that? Instead of, you know, hi John, Alleluia, Christ is risen. Alleluia. You know, why don't we just greet each other like that? But certainly when we go to pray, it can be just helpful to break out of the kind of bland neutrality that we sometimes get into. It can wake us up. We could also pray to the risen Christ. You know, we say, whatever you do, gracious God, almighty Father, you know, whatever your way in. But why not for that, for quite a period, just talk about, pray to the risen Christ. Just reminds us of that central truth of our faith. Practicing the presence of God, practicing the presence of the risen Christ. You know, of Brother Lawrence, this 17th century French monk who spent his life in the kitchens and said he found God just as much in his kitchen as he did in his in the chapel, and he could turn an omelette for the love of God, or pick up a straw from the floor for the love of God. But he was conscious of God's presence with him all the time. Now, if we just practice the presence of the risen Christ by our side, during our ordinary days, it makes life good. Here's another thing, of course, and that's the Benedictine method of greeting, meeting everybody who we come across as Christ, treating everyone we meet as Christ. It's tiring. It's pretty demanding with some of the people you're going to meet, but it does make a real difference. If you see the person you're meeting as Christ, not as, you know, the person who's so irritating. What about using, I use the St. Patrick's breastplate quite often as a way into prayer as well. Christ be with me, Christ within me, Christ behind me, Christ before me, Christ beside me, Christ to win me, Christ to comfort and restore me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ in quiet, Christ in danger, Christ in hearts of all who love me, Christ in mouth of friend and stranger. But the image of the embracing, the surrounding with the risen Christ is again a lovely, strong, but gentle image to take with you into the day. You know, these are all just simple ways of reminding ourselves of the presence of the risen Christ. You know, in Luke, where the angels say, look, he's not here, he's risen, he's going ahead of you into Galilee, you'll see him there. When we pray at the start of the day, we can actually think through the day and think, he's risen. He's gone ahead of me into this day. I will meet him there. I'll meet him in that meeting. I'll meet him with that person. I'll meet him in that task I have. He's gone ahead of us. We'll meet him there. So it's a way of starting the day, looking through the day prayerfully, and with the reassurance that we will meet Christ there. Just using that bit of... And there are lots of other parts of the resurrection narratives we can use in similar ways. So, just simply... Well, there are lots more, but I've run out of time, so I'm not going to... But I do just want to use one more poem. Can I do that? I just think this is lovely. This was a curative of mine in the Diocese of Oxford, who wrote this poem. She was an academic in the university as well. She wrote this poem, As From the Tomb. It is the tomb of Christ speaking. So it's a song for the tomb. Ages before Jerusalem was founded, I was formed for this day. God said, shall these sea bones live? I will sculpt me a tomb, a lime-white chamber fit for a king. I was ready when they brought him in, bloody and broken, like a king from his last battle. Dusk was falling. They hurried, careful, so careful. They were brittle with pain. They straightened him, legs, arms, head, in the niche, stopped my mouth with a rock, and crept away. We were quiet together. He slept inside me. I cradled him like an unborn child. Outside, earth shuddered. The sun failed. Stars shot like bolts through the warring heavens. I kept him safe till he began to stir like the child whose time has come. The deep places of creation whispered, open. A mighty spasm shook the stone. I gaped. He rose. For a moment he stood facing the dawn. Then he was gone. Later there would be angels, blazing-eyed and docile, folding linen bandages. There would be men and women, storms of grieving, suddenly stifled. But first, as the sun rose, there was just light and silence. A cave empty and a world full of promises fulfilled. Do you think that's lovely? Just a lovely way of entering into that story from inside, from being the tomb. Look, I have one last thing to offer you and then see if there's any... anything you want to ask, come back on, say, comment on. This is a diary entry. It's a week in the life of death. And I'd like you just to travel with me and not judge the acting, okay? So this is death writing. Monday. Dear diary, it's me again, death, big D, what a day, busy, 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 like yesterday, and the day before, and the day before that. Tragic cases, really. Some so beautiful, some so young. I nearly wept, you know, but then I didn't bother. Well, must finish. Busy evening ahead. Tuesday. Dear diary. I suppose you think it's a bit soft, really, death writing a diary. But I don't really get to stop in to greet anyone and chat with them. Oh, I meet people, you know, I meet everyone. The great philosophers, you know, the great teachers, the great professionals, you know, religious leaders. I meet them all. But it's all so brief and to the point. Always. Always. Wednesday, dear diary. Two big battles fought today. One in, another in wherever. Now myself, I prefer famines and plagues. Good, steady business with those. Battles, it's all just over in a moment, brushed off your feet. You know, diary, I don't understand these people because, you know, they spend half their time scared stiff of me, trying to avoid me, and then they have a battle. Thursday, dear diary, death. The final frontier, where Captain James T. Kirk most boldly go and boldly go. I'm pretty impressive, really, don't you think? I'm really the ultimate statistic, you know? One in one die. Yeah, I like that. The ultimate statistic. Friday. Dear diary, the ultimate here, but let's not be formal about this. You can call me Sir. Interesting day today. Carpenter's son from Nazareth. Been a lot of fuss about him. Died well. If you can die well. Bit like saying, I failed well. Bit like saying, I swallow-dived off a 100-foot cliff into the yawning mouth of a great white shark and got full marks for style. Saturday. Dear diary. Funny feeling today. Like when you've eaten something that doesn't agree with you. Still, death must go on. It's much more sensible than saying life must go on. Drivel. Life must grovel. I do feel strange. Sunday, Easter, Sunday, Jerusalem, Israel, AD 30. Dear diary, Jesus Christ. That's all I've got to say, really. I've given you precisely 5 minutes to say or ask anything. Sorry.
So if anyone's got any questions, we've got a brief time for questions, if I could encourage you to keep them short, please.
Or comments, or anybody got any good experiences of how to keep Easter alive, you know, how to live Easter through the year. What do you do? So, you know, share things or ask things if you've got anything. If not, don't worry.
So yes. It's more a comment, really.
Yes.
So I sat there looking at my 6 Easter cards on my fireplace, and I thought, oh, those are really nice. And then thought, but actually, I didn't send them at all. So.
Thank you. Yeah, they are there, aren't they?
Proactive.
Yep. Yep. Search them out. And there are some fairly schmaltzy ones, yes, but there are some good ones too. So good to send. Thank you for that reminder. Yeah, please.
Well, just an observation. You covered a huge scheme of things so well. I think actually, and I just noticed it this Easter, so I'll say it. There were some other people there present on Easter Sunday who don't get that much of a mention, but which is an important part of the story, and who were there on night duty guarding the empty tomb.
Right.
And of course they knew and went back, and there's a real life story here because they took money to keep quiet.
Yep.
So there is another angle of the world who can be watching. So don't forget the soldier guards who were probably just trying to do the...
It's always good to enter these stories through the small characters, isn't it? And to think, I wonder what this looked like from that angle. And there are so many people who just get little mentions. And you're absolutely right. Early evidence, I think, of the fearfulness of the Jewish authorities about this story that was getting around, that the body had gone, the tomb was empty. Yes, but we put some guards there, but yes, they fell asleep. We better say they were bright. We better give them money to keep quiet. I mean, there's a whole story in there. Thank you for that reminder. Yes, the little characters, they're very important. I've forgotten that. No, I won't go there. I can't get it right. Okay, anything else? If you are interested... Actually, another thing I meant to mention. In this book that I wrote, there are a lot of home group things as well. For home group sessions based on the 4 different Gospels, and also 4 sessions based on the arts. So, you know, there's poetry, music, painting, and film. And that's another way, I think, of keeping things going, by having, you know, sessions after Easter, not just Lent groups, but after Lent groups on Easter. Let's dig into the story further and live it. Please.
I'm going to use the word dig because something that you haven't mentioned in your book is the idea of an Easter garden, which I think is wonderful, and planting the plants around.
Yes.
So thank you for the
reminders. Good. Will you do it in your home as well as in church? That's the thing. Good. Excellent. I think that would be lovely to do. And I speak to myself about that because I haven't done that. And must do it. Last question, I think.
We've heard about a possible common date for
East to West. Yes.
One argument against that,
yeah.
So those of us who live in London, Richmond, Yorkshire would be a bit more difficult, is that we have here the amazing opportunity to go to the Greek, Russian, Serbian, Romanian cathedrals here in the centre of London and celebrate Easter again in the second.
Yes.
So personally, you know, being in London for double Easter, I hope that we, from that rather selfish point of view, making my way to the Greek cathedral on May the 2nd for the wonderful liturgy there, I hope we don't have a common day.
That's a very good thought. I had not thought of that one. I'm with you. I once went to Thessaloniki for their Easter, which was after ours, and it was wonderful. The place was packed out, 1,000 people in there. You know, we all had our candles, and we streamed out into the streets, and all the candles went out, which is not the symbolism we wanted, of course, but it was, yes, it's just fabulous to be with other communities at their Easter. So, good point. Must write to Justin. Good. Anyway, thank you so much. Final word from our sponsor.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much for being with us today for this session, and thank you very, very much to Bishop John for his words to us and for everything that you've shared with us and for your really great ideas about ways to celebrate Easter. The book that Bishop John has written, Living Easter Through the Year, is available here, and copies are for sale just at the end of this session. The next Sunday forum will be on the 1st of May, at which Jane Williams will be coming to speak to us about the Holy Spirit. The next Cathedral Floor event is on Money and the Kingdom of God with Eve Poole and Angus Ritchie, and that takes place in just under 2 weeks' time on the 12th of April. And if you want any more information about these events or any future events, do go to the website, on the St Paul's website for adult learning, but also do pick up a copy of the brochure, which has a listing of all our spring events available, and these are available on the table just here. So if you could join me, please, in thanking Bishop John for being with us today.